Hi, everybody. My name is Brian Fishman. I'm a fellow here at the New America Foundation. And I have the pleasure today of introducing Peter Bergen, the man that hired me at New America, so that's fun. And Peter doesn't require that much of an introduction. I think he's one of the best known analysts of Al-Qaeda, one of the most experienced analysts of Al-Qaeda in Washington, and one of the most high profile as well. I mean, he's the national security correspondent at CNN. He's been here at New America for years, has a number of books under his belt, including the recent one, Manhunt, about the hunt for bin Laden, the hunt for and ultimately securing of or killing of Osama bin Laden. So I'm just going to tell two brief little anecdotes to try to embarrass Peter before he comes to talk. That people don't know because he is so well known. And the first one is I think that people don't know how sort of unceremonial Peter actually is. And that's hallmarked by the fact that I wasn't actually going to introduce him today. He just sort of wanted to do this himself, not have an introduction. And one of our sort of organizers, Faith Smith, or one of our gurus back there, said, "Brian, you've got to come do this. You've got to. He can't introduce himself. Somebody's got to introduce him." So please go ahead. Which I think says something about sort of Peter's where Peter's focus has always been. And this is one of the things I've learned from working with him: is he cares about getting things done and accomplishments, and not so much the ceremonial aspects, which is really to his credit, I think. And then the second thing that I just want to retell a short story. We were talking about the end of the sort of finishing of Manhunt, and I asked Peter what his next project was going to be, and he said, I'm going to take a little bit of downtime. And I said, yeah, I mean, you've been working your butt off on this thing for over a year. And he said, actually, it's been since 9/11. And I think that perspective is really kind of interesting, where Peter has been one of the leading, if not the leading analyst of Al-Qaeda for the entire duration since 9/11 and beforehand, when he was paying attention, but the rest of us were not. And so I hope you do get some downtime. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Peter to talk about the book. I'll ask a few questions, and then we'll turn it over to the audience.
Thank you, Brian, for that very kind invitation. And thank you, everybody, for coming today. What I thought I would do is talk about the big themes that I, when I started writing the book, and arguably I've been writing it for a long time, at least in my head. I basically had a year, or less than a year, to write and research and edit the book. And as I sat down to write it, I did something which I hadn't done really when writing a book before, which is really think about what are the big sort of themes that I need to think about rather than just start writing. And so there were five or six sort of themes that I thought were important to think about as I was writing the book. First of all, President Obama as a commander-in-chief was an important theme. Secondly, and as a decision-maker generally, secondly, the sort of evolution, the Agatha Christie story of how the courier was found at the CIA. Thirdly, the evolution of JSOC, Joint Special Operations Command, which obviously was critical to if this is basically an Agatha Christie story with the James Bond ending, JSOC supplied the sort of James Bond aspect of it, and the CIA supplied the Agatha Christie aspect of it. Another big theme was kind of the evolution of the U.S.-Pakistani relationship, because, of course, this whole event happened in the context of a much worsening U.S.-Pakistan relationship. And the final sort of related big theme was, what was bin Laden doing and what essentially had happened to Al-Qaeda in the years that he was on the run. So those were the sort of themes that I thought were sort of important to think about as I was writing the book. And just to sort of take them in more or less in the order that I just laid out, President Obama is probably the first winner of the Nobel Peace Prize who went in his acceptance speech laid out his philosophy of war. And his philosophy of war in the Nobel Prize acceptance speech at Oslo, I thought was a very interesting way to think about President Obama as a commander-in-chief. He said, and I'm paraphrasing, when he accepted the Nobel Peace Prize, which, by the way, happened a week after he had publicly announced the surge of 30,000 more troops into Afghanistan, he said, essentially, much as I admire the tradition of Gandhi and of Martin Luther King, it wouldn't have done much to stop the Nazis. and you can't really negotiate with Al Qaeda. And in fact, a defense, it was essentially a defense of just war theory, and it, President Obama wound up his observations by sort of saying, you know, he wasn't sort of endorsing the use of violence, but in certain situations it becomes necessary, because essentially, you know, any student of human history can tell that at certain points violence will be necessary to achieve your goals. And of course, President Obama has turned out to be quite a disappointing president for many people who voted for him on the basis of the fact that he might be the anti-war president. But in fact, if you go back to, and as I do in the book, on August, I think August 1st, 2007, President, then-candidate Obama gave a speech at the Woodrow Wilson Center, which was understood by the people in his team, which included Susan Rice, Dennis McDonough, and Ben Rhodes, that this was going to be a very critical speech, because it was going to be the kind of foreign policy speech of the candidate that was going to get the most notice. And they labored over a particular line in the speech for quite some period of time. The line essentially was, if President Musharraf won't do enough to go after Al-Qaeda high-value targets in Pakistan, we reserve the right to unilaterally do so. Now, as you may recall, then-candidate Obama was roundly criticized by both Republicans and Democrats for this. Mitt Romney described him as a Dr. Strangelove at the time. John McCain, Hillary Clinton, Senator Christopher Dodd, they all basically criticized President Obama for this statement, saying that, you know, we shouldn't unilaterally attack one of our allies. No one really took candidate Obama seriously enough, but clearly he was serious about this. And when it came down to the decision in the Situation Room about a unilateral raid, President Obama pushed back against a number of people who said that was the wrong thing to do. The final scene in the book, one of the final scenes in the book, is the April 28th meeting, in which was the crucial National Security Council meeting, the last of five, in which basically President Obama went around the room and asked everybody for their advice. And the advice that he received from Secretary of Defense Robert Gates, who'd served every president since Richard Nixon, was don't do the raid. And in fact, do something slightly different, which was use a small munition bomb. It's called a small tactical munition. It's never been used in combat. No one, when I reported the book, would tell me directly exactly about this. Talking to enough people, it became clear to me that this small tactical munition is a 13-pound bomb that's been developed by Raytheon, amongst others. And Admiral Mullen, in particular, was not happy with this concept at all, saying, look, we rely too much on technology, and what if this doesn't work? So Secretary Robert Gates was against the unilateral raid, and Vice President Biden, of course, was against the unilateral raid. Why was Vice President Biden, why was Gates against the raid? I think Gates was particularly concerned about the ground communications through Pakistan supplying NATO troops in Afghanistan. He, of course, had been in the White House as Operation Eagle Claw, often known as Operation Desert One, had gone on the night of April 24th, 25th, 1980, he was in the White House as the executive assistant to then CIA Director Stansfield Turner, when that operation basically went, you know, completely, everything that could go wrong with it did go wrong, as you may recall. Eight American servicemen died. I think Joe Biden was concerned about an embassy overrun in Pakistan, as you may recall, in 1979, an enraged mob, enraged by the Salman Rushdie affair, burned to the ground the U.S. Embassy in Islamabad, something that was on Vice President Joe Biden's mind. So there was quite a lot of pushback. And so there was a certain narrative, which obviously I didn't know about when I was writing the book, but after the book came out, there were, you know, a lot of Mitt Romney in particular said, look, every president would have made this decision, including Jimmy Carter. Well, Jimmy Carter did make this decision. He made him a one-term president. He made a form of this decision that was a disaster. So the idea that just any president would have made this decision, I think I think is very implausible. You know, the two most senior out of three of President Obama's advisors were advising something different. And there was certainly, by the way, some cost to doing nothing, because at a certain, in the final meeting on April 28th, Leon Panetta said, Mr. President, I use a test which is, if a group of ordinary American citizens were in the room, what would they say if they knew what we know now? I think they would say we should do this. And so I'm not saying that there were no costs. There might have been costs also, by the way, of doing nothing or just waiting, because, of course, the intelligence, you know, bin Laden may have gone, or, you know, there were a lot of different things that could have happened. The surveillance operation might have been discovered in Abbottabad, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But so Obama is a decision maker, very well calibrated, very careful. Think about this decision started, the decision-making process started in August of 2010 and culminated in May of 2011. It was almost a year of very, very careful thinking about this issue. A president very comfortable with use of American power. He's the first major American political figure in decades who what he did or did not do in Vietnam isn't front and center of his brain. So, you know, Bill Clinton, Dick Cheney, George W. Bush didn't serve in Vietnam, and that is part of their story. and of course, John McCain and John Kerry did, and it's very much part of their stories. And so I think President Obama and a number of his younger advisors are just not burdened by the Vietnam syndrome that an older generation of Democrats were. Then on the evolution of JSOC, you know, obviously the hero of that story in many ways is Stan McChrystal. Let's say President George W. Bush had the same kind of intelligence picture that was developed about Abbottabad in 2002 and picked up the phone and called the then head of JSOC essentially to do this operation in Pakistan, it may well have gone wrong. I think that's uncontroversial. As you know, there have been, you know, what Stan McChrystal and to some degree also his deputy, then Colonel Mike Flynn, now Lieutenant General Mike Flynn, did with JSOC in Iraq is really turn what was described as the Ferrari in the garage that was never used into something that was really an incredibly agile killing machine. And they did that. I have a chapter in the book about how they were able to achieve that. You know, one of the main ways they achieved that was moving the whole operation out of the United States and not even out of Baghdad and putting it in Balad Air Force Base, far away from all the sort of, you know, typical kind of constraints that would develop in Washington and people not taking decisions because they're frightened of failure, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. McChrystal, I think the motto there was 17-2-5, which is 17 hours of work, 2 hours of relaxation, and 5 hours of sleep. So it was in a very intense environment. And, you know, there are many reasons why the Iraq war turned around. You're very familiar with the laundry list of the surge, the awakening, previous ethnic cleansing, General Petraeus. I mean, to that list, obviously, JSOC must be added. And then Admiral McRaven himself, as a sort of person, is a very interesting character, I think, in the book. I mean, his book, Special Operations, which he published in 1995, is really the key to thinking about how Abbottabad went forward. He looked at 8 special operations, 7 from World War II, and 1, the raid on Entebbe. And in fact, if there's a hero of McRaven's book, it's Jonathan Netanyahu, Bibi's older brother, who, of course, died in the raid of Entebbe and who led the raid of Entebbe. And the raid of Entebbe is an interesting, just think about the contrast between Abbottabad and Entebbe. In Entebbe, the Palestinians had taken, hostage takers had taken a number of Israeli hostages. And at the time, it was inconceivable that you would fly 7 hours to Uganda, where they were being held, from Israel, that you would land at the airport and do a hostage rescue operation. When the Israelis got off the plane, they were all dressed in Ugandan military uniforms. They got the details so perfectly that they were driving Mercedes that a Ugandan general would drive. And so they had the advantage of total surprise. They rescued the hostages in 3 minutes. And so there were a number of lessons that McRaven took from this raid and others. Another interesting one is the rescue of Mussolini by the Nazis when Mussolini had been taken by Italian partisans. The Nazis rescued him using hang gliders in an area where no one ever would, a mountainous area where no one ever would have thought that hang gliders would ever be able to land. And they didn't fire a shot when they rescued Mussolini. It was a sort of perfect special forces operation. And so McRaven derived a number of kind of larger lessons from these 8 case studies. And he interviewed almost everybody who had been involved in these operations and actually visited the sites where they happened. And some of them are kind of obvious, like surprise. Some of them are less obvious, perhaps, repetition. One of the reasons Operation Eagle Claw failed was they never rehearsed. No one rehearsed the operation repeatedly. And that, of course, is one of the keys to success. Another big theme, just moving on through the list I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, is what was bin Laden doing? And I think, you know, we all know the story of the Battle of Tora Bora. I won't detain you with that. But in, how is Al-Qaeda doing in this period? I had written a previous book, The Longest War, which came out in the middle of January of 2011. It happened before the Arab Spring and obviously before the death of bin Laden. But I think the theme of The Longest War was Al-Qaeda has been losing the war of ideas in the Muslim world for a very long time. Their ability to do an attack on the West is very constrained. And I think the events of the Arab Spring and the death of bin Laden amply kind of confirm those kind of conclusions. The U.S.-Pakistan relationship obviously has never really been worse, unfortunately. And it peaked, arguably, with the Raymond Davis affair. Now, when you think about the president's decision-making process and all this, bear in mind that Raymond Davis is in prison as these decisions are being made. And Raymond Davis, there was a great deal of concern at the National Security Council that Davis might be killed in prison, that there was a very great deal of concern that he might be killed if this operation went forward. There was also a very great deal of concern in the National Security Council that if the operation went wrong in Abbottabad, that instead of one Raymond Davis in prison, you'd have 24 Raymond Davises, who are not Raymond Davis-like people, but 24 U.S. Navy SEALs who might get involved in some sort of hostage problem. So on March 16th, Raymond Davis was released from Pakistani jail, a very interesting story about how that happened. Basically by paying blood money for the fact that he killed two Pakistanis. And that, I think, helped the decision to move forward, because if Davis had still been in jail, it might have been a more complicated decision. But the Davis kind of story also very much influenced how Abbottabad was constructed as an operation. I quote Admiral Mullen in the book. He was absolutely adamant that this is something that he wanted to put on the record, that it was President Obama who said we need to make this operation a larger operation than is presently being presented, by which he meant we need more quick reaction force, we need more helicopters, because what if something goes wrong? Because when McRaven had come to President Obama with the initial plan, he had believed that it was predicated on the idea that we should not anger the Pakistanis unnecessarily, and so he put in a relatively small package. Obama basically said, go back to the drawing board. So instead of two or three helicopters, it became five helicopters, two Blackhawks and three Chinooks, two of which were landed relatively close to Abbottabad and one of which just remained on the Afghan-Pakistan border. And of course, something did go wrong, and the backup was necessary. But this all happened in the context of a very, very difficult U.S.-Pakistani relationship. And of course, this is one of the reasons the U.S.-Pakistani relationship continues to get worse and worse. Interesting sort of minor point on this. The reason that President Obama went out at 11:35 on Sunday night on May 1st to make this announcement about Osama bin Laden being killed was because the Pakistanis put pressure on the administration to announce it. You may recall that there was not a 100% DNA match. There was a 95% DNA match that evening. There was a very good facial recognition match, but there wasn't 100%. And President Obama was extremely reluctant to go out and have a 5% chance of being wrong about a rather important issue. And what happened was Mullen calls General Kiani probably about 5 a.m. Pakistani time, 8 p.m. Washington time, and says, we've killed Osama bin Laden. And Kiani by now was aware that something along those lines probably had happened. And his first reaction is congratulations from Kiani. The second is the rest of the 20-minute phone call is pretty tense. And Kiani basically says, look, we have a helicopter down that is obviously not a Pakistani helicopter in Abbottabad. We have media already gathering at the site. We can't explain this because it's not our operation. You are going to have to go out and explain this as fast as possible because no one will understand unless it's an operation to get Osama bin Laden. Then it becomes a lot more understandable. And so Mullen comes back into the Situation Room and says, Kiani wants us to go out and make this public. And there were other people in the Situation Room, particularly on the communication side, who were saying, look, we need to get out there and we need to explain what happened. So the declining U.S.-Pakistani relationship was part of all this. And then, what is this, I guess, in wrapping this up, what does this all mean? You could make the argument that at the end of the day, bin Laden was sort of irrelevant by the time he was killed. So does that mean, therefore, that the operation itself was irrelevant and my book doesn't mean anything and nobody should read it? Or Or does it mean something else? And obviously I have a very strong self-interest in saying that it does matter. And I think it does matter. You know, there's no doubt that bin Laden had become less and less relevant over time. There's no doubt that Al-Qaeda has become less and less relevant over time. And in fact, today they pose, you know, a extraordinarily marginal threat to the United States itself. That said, you know, there is the matter of justice for the many victims of 9/11, not only the people who lost their lives, but their families. I don't think you could kind of close the chapter on the war on terror without killing or capturing Osama bin Laden. Because at the end of the day, what was the war on terror about? It was really about finding one person. I mean, if the Taliban had handed over Osama bin Laden in October or November of 2011, history would have been very different. We might not have invaded Afghanistan. I think it would have been impossible to have invaded Iraq. I think the whole history of the whole national security history that we are so familiar with of the last decade plus would have been very different. And so, you know, I think a way of ending the war on terror or the war against Al-Qaeda and its allies was to capture or kill bin Laden. And I think, you know, the night that bin Laden was killed, I went on CNN and Wolf Blitzer turned to me and said, "What's your reaction?" I hadn't really sort of, it was immediately after the president stopped speaking. And I said, the war on terror is over. We can more or less announce that right now. And I think that's still a very defensible statement. You know, we have a choice now. We can sort of say, well, you know, the war on terror continues because there are still members of Al-Qaeda and they still pose some kind of threat. I think that's a kind of lazy way to think about things. We can't be in a state of kind of quasi-permanent war against a group of people that don't pose much of a threat to us. I think that it's very hard for a politician like President Obama or any politician to say, you know, essentially we have won against Al-Qaeda and we can just declare victory and move on. Because what if we're even 1% wrong? The political costs of having an attack that could be traced in any way to Al-Qaeda or like-minded groups, even with a small death toll, would be very high if you'd made that kind of statement. But I think people in my position or people in Brian's position who are, you know, sort of have credibility in the field, I think that we almost have an obligation to sort of say this problem is really been managed. And there's two parts to this. It's Al-Qaeda's own weaknesses, which are just, you know, manifold. And then it's our own strength, relatively speaking. I mean, just to throw out just a couple of observations on that point. On 9/11, there were 16 people on the no-fly list. Today, there are 21,000. On 9/11, there was no TSA. Today, there is a TSA. You can debate whether that's in a perfect world it would exist, but it does exist. On 9/11, there was no DHS. On 9/11, the CIA and the FBI didn't talk to each other, basically. On 9/11, there were just a few joint terrorism task forces. Now, there are more than 100. We have 860,000 Americans with top-secret clearances. We have a huge national security industrial complex. It used to get like, you know, $25 billion a year just for intelligence. Now it's $80 billion. You know, and we're in a time of budgetary constraints. We need to be thinking about, you know, reformulating that, I think. And also thinking about the other sort of white swans or gray swans or black swans that may be coming down the pike that aren't Al-Qaeda. Because after all, you know, 9/11 was a big surprise to a lot of people. It maybe shouldn't have been, but there will be other threats that we need to think about. And I think the cyber attacks that we've launched on Iran are something that we should be having a public discussion about, because there's a certain point, we're not going to enjoy a monopoly on this forever, this kind of technology. And it is not inconceivable that a state might try and attack us in a similar manner. So with that, I'll take some questions from Brian and any questions that you might have.
I guess I'm just going to ask a couple of questions and then turn it over to the audience. But the first question that I have is about there was this small cadre of people, right? You outside of government looking at problems like Al-Qaeda, but then there were people inside of government that were dealing with issues on the sort of margins of Al-Qaeda or groups that later came to be part of Al-Qaeda. And one of the things that struck me in sort of the Agatha Christie part of the story that you wrote is how our intelligence agencies went back to look at other manhunts in history, right? They went to find, how did they find Miramal Casey? How did they find various drug lords? Those sorts of things. And that was reminiscent, frankly, of some of the story in Josh Meyer and Terry McDermott's book about Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and some of the people that were chasing him around before we understood who he was going to be. So my question is, for this cadre of people, you included, that were looking at this problem before 9/11, I mean, do you find that it's going to be hard for those people to sort of let go of Al-Qaeda? I mean, you're urging all of us to do that, but that's, you don't hear that from everybody in that sort of position.
Right. Well, I mean, I think that's a very interesting question, because clearly, I mean, the Soviet Union officially dissolved itself on a certain day, I'd forgotten, in 1990, and Al-Qaeda is never going to officially dissolve itself, and there's going to be no surrender agreement with Al-Qaeda, as there were with the Nazis. So we know for a fact that there's no way to sort of end it in an official way. So we need to start talking about it, because they won't talk about it. And I think that one way to think about it, which might be a more politically sellable way to talk about it, is when Leon Panetta talked last year about we are close to strategically defeating Al-Qaeda, that's a very interesting formulation, because it doesn't suggest that we have completely eradicated Al-Qaeda. It suggests that Al-Qaeda doesn't pose a strategic threat to the United States. And I think that is an incontrovertible truth. What is a strategic threat to the United States? Well, when Pan Am 103 blew up over Scotland, the George H.W. Bush administration, killing 270 Americans, did not go to war with Libya, Iran, or Syria, or any of the people who were believed to be behind it. Similarly, when Oklahoma City blew up, you know, that wasn't seen as a sort of absolutely existential threat to American national security. 9/11 clearly was that event. So I think by saying we have strategically defeated Al-Qaeda, it leaves you the sufficient wiggle room for a Major Nadal Hassan influenced by Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula killing 13 Americans at Fort Hood, so that you can say, well, we didn't mean that, you know, nobody, you know, that this ideology is being completely exterminated. But I think there will be people, for all sorts of reasons, who, I don't want to cast aspersions on people's motives. You know, if people, because I think it is a very strongly held view by some people that this is still a very, very large problem. And, you know, I would say maybe one way of answering that, Brian, is I think that when people say the sky is going to fall, and the sky never falls, usually, they're very rarely held to account. I mean, to give you just one example, somebody whose work I greatly admire is Graham Allison. In 2004, he wrote that within a decade, there would be a terrorist attacking the United States with nuclear weapons. Well, we're about 2 years from, and I don't think it's, you know, from that deadline, and there's really no evidence of that. And so, you know, I think that there will be people who continue to believe this is a big problem, and you know, they may well be right. I hope they're not. And there is, you know, for people in this room, I think it's a well-known fact that 6 out of 10 of the richest counties in the United States are now in the Washington, D.C. area. And before 9/11, there was only one that fell into that category. So, you know, if Bin Laden thought that the war on terror was going to bankrupt us, he's not a particularly good economist, because in fact, wars have they're a huge Keynesian pump into the economy, particularly the Washington economy, where it's true in Vietnam and it's true in World War II. So yes, there are people who probably have an interest, whether it's of all kinds, to the whole infrastructure is built up around this. Mm-hmm. And sort of, I think it's impossible to kill government structures once they're in, once they exist. I think. I mean, that's one of sort of iron law of Washington. So, you know, but I think that there are voices who are beginning to say, look, when Leon Panetta says it, I mean, he's got a lot of credibility on this issue. The president at Bagram Air Force Base on May 2nd, came. He said we're close to defeating mm-hmm. Al-Qaeda. So I'm sure, he believes that, and I think that is a very accurate statement.
You're uniquely positioned among virtually any American to make to speculate, at least intelligently, about what somebody like Osama bin Laden may have been thinking in these last few years. Met him. We've talked in the past, and you've said, this is somebody that was a true religious fanatic to the end. Is it your impression, after looking into his experience and his existence over the last 5 years of his life, that he may have had regrets, that he wished he took a different path in life.
I think je regrette rien would be his sort of general, you know, kind of response to that. You know, I think, you know, bin Laden, as Brian says, I mean, he was a religious fanatic from the age of about 12 or 13. And, and that just hardened and hardened and hardened. So I don't think he had any regrets. You know, one of the things that I was able to do for the book was to get inside the compound where bin Laden died. It was interesting. It kind of, there's no substitute for being in the place where these things happened. And, you know, bin Laden didn't go out with a spectacular martyrdom. He died surrounded by his wives and kids in a kind of squalid suburban compound. And his life was, in the end, confined to a room about the size of the area where Brian and I are talking in, which was his study, and then another bedroom. You know, he had a toilet about the size of this lectern, and a small kitchen maybe twice the size of this lectern where his 29-year-old Yemeni wife would cook him dinner. It was a pretty, I don't know, it was not the spectacular martyrdom at Tora Bora that he might have sort of, people thought he might be, have wanted to do. But did he have any regrets? I don't see any of that. I mean, we've had, as you know, Brian used to be at West Point. We've had the West Point releases of the 17 documents. And I think those documents, are they representative of the whole trove? They seem to me to be probably representative. People have said they're representative. Of course, the government has released documents that put bin Laden and al-Qaeda in a very poor light. But I think their concerns, as expressed in those documents, were very real. We are worried about the drones. We think the al-Qaeda brand name has been tarnished. We're very worried about money. Mm-hmm. I mean, so I don't think he had regrets. I think he had some pretty pressing concerns about the health of his organization. And, you know, when he's advising Al-Shabaab, the Somali affiliate of Al-Qaeda, not to use the Al-Qaeda brand name because it would be bad for fundraising and also would attract undue negative attention, I mean, I think that sort of speaks for itself. I think he's conscious. They're very conscious about how badly Al-Qaeda in Iraq had tarnished their image, as you know. And, you know, I think we knew that. We assumed that, but also it's interesting to see that they internally said the same thing. And they're advising the Taliban to stop killing Pakistani civilians. They understood that they understood all their Achilles' heels, but the, you know, al-Qaeda and the groups sort of that are inspired by it understand their strategic problems. They just don't seem to be able to do anything to really stop them.
The compound where bin Laden lived and was ultimately killed, you know, seemed to be, you know, at least purpose built for this purpose, and it was purchased. It seems like there was some infrastructure around this man helping to facilitate this environment. Is it plausible that that went on without at least elements of the Pakistani intelligence services knowing what was going on?
There's no evidence that, I mean, I, you know, this is a very big question, and there's no evidence that the Pakistani intelligence or any government official helped bin Laden. And I intuitively believe that as I started reporting the book for two reasons. First of all, al-Qaeda has declared war on the Pakistani state. They tried to kill Musharraf twice in December of 2003. There's no love lost between al-Qaeda and the Pakistani state. Secondly, having had some experience of dealing with bin Laden and his inner circle, he's a very paranoid, secretive, disciplined people. Why would they involve anybody that they didn't completely control? Thirdly, as I began reporting the book, there were people living in the compound, adults who didn't know bin Laden was living there. So the courier's wife one day saw a strange Arab, tall, who was living on the compound. She'd been instructed by her husband for several years, we have somebody here, you cannot talk about him to me or to anybody else. So, you know, bin Laden was hiding from people inside his own compound. He wasn't trying to expand the kind of concentric circles of people who knew where he was. There was, in my mind, there's no Pakistani complicity. Now we do have 4 terabytes of data that was recovered. It has been gone through. I think if there was a smoking gun, you know, U.S.-Pakistani relations are such that we would have, you know, the government would have said something, the U.S. government would have said something about it. But, you know, we'll still, the definitive book about Pearl Harbor was written in 1962. So, I mean, we're going to still be finding out things for years that we don't know. One of the things that I thought was, I wish I'd had when the book came, before I'd finished the book, was the police report, the Islamabad police report of the interrogation of his youngest wife, which really kind of filled in some details about what he was doing between 2002 and 2005. So there will be other things that come out, and the wives now are in Saudi Arabia. You know, people that we live in an open society, my guess is that other people involved in the operation are going to, Bob Gates is writing a book. I can't believe that you won't mention some of this. You know, there will be other books.
Seems relevant.
So things will be coming out. I mean, it's I loved writing this book. I mean, it was a huge crash, but there's a great thing in a way to have a real deadline, not a deadline, because I tended in my previous books to say, can I take another year? And, you know, it was great. It kind of really helped me sort of focus. And, it's an amazing tale. And, you know, it's one of those tales where, there are a lot of people who come out of it very well. There's a great line in the book about Liam Panetta, who's an amazing guy to be around. He's very, very funny. And I asked him, what did you think that morning when you were going in to, basically be overseeing the raid? And he said, I looked at myself in the mirror when I was shaving, and I said, the next time I look at this face, I'm either going to be fine, or I'm going to have to be explaining a lot of things to a lot of people, which I thought was a great line. But go back to this question of, was this an easy call? One of the only characters in the book who's there on 9/11 and also there the day that Bin Laden is killed is the deputy director of the CIA, Mike Morrell, who was the briefer on 9/11, who basically talked to Bush on Air Force One about who the likely kind of candidates for this, who had done this attack. And Mike Morrell talks to Liam Panetta at 1 o'clock on the day of the raid, and Mike says to Panetta, or maybe Panetta says to Morrell, where are you, Mike, on this? And he says, Bin Laden is either there or he's not there. And Panetta says, that's where I am. They really did not know. There was people saying 90%, people saying 40%. The percentages gave a sort of false sort of view that, a false kind of precision. I mean, at the end of the day, Bin Laden was either 100% there or either 100% not there. He wasn't 40% there. And so, that's why, when President Obama went back at 7 p.m. to the private part, his residence in the White House, that's a pretty heavy set of decisions. And, over the course of 11 hours, 13 hours, he came to the decision, it's a go. But it wasn't clear to anybody involved that that was necessarily the right decision.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask you a brief two-part question, right. I've got to run. But the first part is, where do you see Bin Laden's successor going, and do you have any insights on Ayman al-Zawahiri?
Yeah, I think Ayman al-Zawahiri has inherited the blockbuster video of global jihad. There's nowhere to go except down.
And what about that? I mean, just reports today of discussions reportedly within the U.S. military and with the Afghan special forces to potentially raid Pakistani territory to target other militant groups, the Haqqanis, etc. Based on the experience with the Pakistanis after the Bin Laden raid, do you have thoughts about the wisdom of that course of action?
Well, I think it would be quite unwise. Mm-hmm. I think it's pretty clear that that would be probably the end of what remains of the U.S.-Pakistani relationship. Mm-hmm. I think the Pakistanis would respond with force. I mean, they've made it very clear, I think, on that subject. Mm-hmm. And my understanding from reading the AFPAC Channel Daily Brief, a product of New America Foundation, every morning, is that that discussion, I think General Allen basically said, we're not going to. That's a bridge too far.
Yeah, absolutely. With that, I'm going to turn it over to questions from the audience. We should have some folks with a mic, Fatima. And why don't we start right up here?
Thank you, Brian. Thanks a lot.
See you later.
Peter, good to see you again. It's a little bit outside the scope, but I'm curious, do you think, given all the times we had Bin Laden in our sights before 9/11, do you think we could have prevented 9/11 by taking him out on any one of those occasions?
I think there is a debate about how many times we have bin Laden in our sights before 9/11. On one side of that debate is Mike Scheuer, who ran the bin Laden unit, who says there were 10 occasions. And on the other side of that debate is Richard Clark, who was the chief counterterrorism advisor to George W. Bush, and also to Bill Clinton, that we had bin Laden in our sights 3 times. So. But there was one particular time when it seemed like the most promising shot, which was in Kandahar in 98, outside Kandahar. A group of Emirati princes who were hunting bustards were in the desert with a camp, and bin Laden was visiting. And the shot wasn't taken because what if bin Laden wasn't there and you ended up incinerating half the Emirati royal family? That was regarded as being kind of not worth it. Historians will debate whether that was a right call or a wrong call. I guess they'll probably say that was a wrong call. Although bin Laden was there for, it was much harder to do an attack. Go back to the pre-9/11 era. There are no armed drones. The only way to do the attack is, there are only 2 ways to do the attack. One is cruise missiles. Well, cruise missiles, they have to fly from the Arabian Sea. So then they have to spin up in their tubes, and then they have to fly several hours across Pakistan and then Afghanistan to reach their target. So it's not a snap decision. There's at least a 12-hour sort of lag between deciding to do something and being able to execute. And then bin Laden can be wandering off somewhere else in that course of that time. The other way to get him at the time was to send in Afghan tribals who were on the CIA payroll, but they were, they'd had some extremely confusing instructions from the CIA, because the CIA and the Clinton administration, the NSC, seem to have rather different views about what the instructions were. So in the CIA's view of the matter, they largely thought that if it was a ground operation, it was kind of a capture bin Laden operation, and if he got killed in the process of it, that was okay, but it wasn't intended to be an assassination operation. I guess the Clinton NSC sort of felt it was more of a kill bin Laden operation. Anyway, so there was some confusion about the rules of engagement. The CIA, the Afghan tribals, were not the most organized group. And so in the end, these shots weren't taken either with cruise missiles or Afghan allies on the ground. Would it have prevented 9/11 if we'd done that? I mean, it might have, if it had been early enough. Because at the end of the day, bin Laden was one of the things I try and say in the book. When I wrote Holy War Inc., which was the first of 4 books I've written about this, I thought that Ayman al-Zawahiri was the brains of the operation, and that was kind of the view that I'd been heard from a lot of people in Egypt. And Ayman al-Zawahiri is a smart guy, but I mean, over the 14 years, over the 12 years that sort of I've been writing about it, I began to realize that was wrong. In fact, bin Laden, Zawahiri was focused on one thing, overthrowing the Egyptian government. And by the time that he and bin Laden hooked up for the second time in the mid-90s, Zawahiri was the penniless leader of a very small jihad group who was not well-liked or well-regarded, whereas bin Laden was becoming a global celebrity and he had this big organization. And so at the end of the day, it was bin Laden's idea to do 9/11. And there was quite a lot of pushback within al-Qaeda about whether 9/11 was a good idea. Some people were saying, hey, this is probably against Islam, which of course it is, even within al-Qaeda. Other people were saying, this is going to really anger the Taliban. The Taliban have repeatedly put us on notice not to anger the United States, which clearly this will. So if you've taken bin Laden out, particularly early in the game, at a certain point the 9/11 train was leaving the station. I mean, let's say by the time a lot of flight lessons were happening, a lot of money transfers from Dubai were happening to the United States, the hijackers were arriving in the United States. By then, it was too late. But if you go back to the 98-99 time period, it might not have been too late. After all, Mohammed Atta, the lead hijacker, only arrived in Afghanistan in 99. And the arrival of Mohammed Atta made the whole thing much more likely to succeed, because Atta and the people with him were people who understood the West, and Atta had a PhD from a German university. The people that they had recruited previously were all sort of Yemenis and Saudis who weren't necessarily that sophisticated. So, I think if he'd been killed early on, history would have been different. Fatima, just here in front.
Yeah, Peter, you have commented on... I'm sorry, you have commented on Carter's decision in the Iranian hostage and how that
that failed, and then compared that to the Obama decision. And of course, as we know, in the Carter situation, Carter overruled the military and took less than they were recommending. And in this case, Obama overruled the military and took more force than they recommended. What caused him to do what he did? Did he get outside advice or some other advice from other than his own military planners?
Well, the military advice that Obama was getting was kind of split. There's the kind of narrow question of the plan that McRaven initially presented, which was too small in Obama's view. But that wasn't because McRaven had been ordered to do something small. He sort of felt that his marching orders had been to not anger the Pakistanis. So he just went back to the drawing board and they produced a bigger operation. So there was really no dispute about that. I think where the bigger kind of dispute, it wasn't even a dispute, the General Cartwright, who was the number two military advisor to the president, was advocating a small bomb, a drone strike using this experimental munition that I mentioned. Was he advocating that because he felt that that was his position as the military advisor to to kind of be the institutional voice of a position that needed to be taken into consideration? Or was he advocating that because he really believed in it? I'm not entirely sure. But, people in the room felt that he either one of those things. Then, of course, General Robert Gates was against the raid for the reasons we've already discussed. On the other side of the equation, Admiral Mullen was very much in favor of the raid from the beginning. Yeah. And so this is very unusual because if you think about the history of the Obama administration, usually Gates and Mullen were in lockstep, for instance, about the size of the surge in Afghanistan and other issues. But in this case, they were on opposite sides. So Obama was getting kind of conflicting military advice. On the issue of Carter, I don't know enough about it except to say that I read the Holloway Commission, which was the investigation, and of the Operation Equal Claw Desert One, and it's fascinating because JSOC, and I should have said this earlier, JSOC was created as a result of the failure of Operation Equal Claw Desert One. Why is Joint Special Operations Command? Everything that could go wrong with the Iranian operation did go wrong, and it was an accident waiting to happen. All four of the services wanted to be involved in this incredibly prestigious rescue of the hostages in Iran. And yet none of them have ever done a special operation together. Everything was kept at a very highly classified level, so very few people actually understood what was going to happen. The Navy didn't service the helicopters sufficiently, so they had developed mechanical problems. There were, as you may recall, desert storms creating these very intense sandstorms that wore down the helicopters. And so every piece of this, the whole thing was predicated on something that even today would be enormously impossible, very, very difficult. They were going to land in the Iranian desert, maybe 800 miles from Tehran. They were then going to go into a very large city with millions of people, go to the embassy, which was protected by the Revolutionary Guards, rescue the Americans there, and then get out. I mean, even if everything worked perfectly, it was a very, very unlikely to succeed, and everything did go wrong. And so as a result of which Joint Special Operations Command came forward, one thing that I do say in the book, which I think is an important point, Joint Special Operations was not, you asked about, if bin Laden had been killed before 9/11. President Clinton asked then General Hugh Shelton, maybe a couple of years before 9/11, he said, basically, I apologize for the exact language here in advance, I don't think this is a children's program. He said to Shelton, look, it would scare the shit out of Al-Qaeda if the black ninjas rappelled into their camp and attacked them. And it would also be a big psychological victory for us. And I don't recall exactly what Shelton said, but Shelton and the people inside the U.S. military, the higher in the army, when the Clinton administration was asking for plans to attack bin Laden in Afghanistan, they came back with basically politically unsustainable plans for Normandy-style invasions of Afghanistan. That's a slight exaggeration, but I quote, I think, Mike Shore in the book. Clinton wanted a rapier, and they kept giving him a sledgehammer. And so the Ferrari in the garage I mentioned earlier, this is General Shoemaker, who was head of special operations. He said, look, it was very frustrating. The Ferrari was always kept in the garage, and we didn't use it. And it was only after 9/11 that it began to be used. And of course, the rest is history. But so in terms of Obama was getting kind of mixed signals from the military about the right way to proceed. In the back?
Thank you. My name is Said Zafar Hashimi from Voice of America's Afghanistan service. Today, John Allen, the commander of international forces in Afghanistan, said that today's Kabul, he saw a signature of Haqqani network in today's attacks in Kabul. And Clinton earlier had said that she didn't say it clearly, but she kind of indicated that the U.S. might negotiate with Haqqani network in order to resolve the issue of Afghanistan. Do you think the U.S. is allowing or ignoring Haqqani network to become a big terrorist organization in a way that it might attack the U.S. later on, as was Al-Qaeda at the beginning, not as big as it was during 9/11? And sure. Second question is about your book. Did you get a chance to talk to Dr. Afridi, the Pakistani doctor who helped with finding DNAs of...
I did not speak to Dr. Afridi, who was convicted of treason and now... No, he was convicted of helping a Taliban insurgent group, which is kind of ironic because he was actually kidnapped by this Taliban insurgent group and was forced to perform medical treatment on them. He didn't do it voluntarily. And so the charge that he's been, he hasn't been convicted of treason, he's been convicted of helping a Taliban insurgent group who actually kidnapped him. But I was not able to speak to Afridi, and I don't think anybody will for any, length of time. In terms of the Haqqani network attacking the United States directly, I don't think it's not implausible. Pakistani Taliban did send Faisal Shahzad to Times Square. On May 1st, 2010, he did try and blow up an SUV in Times Square at 6 p.m. on a Saturday night, which is a very good time to kill a lot of people. Luckily, it didn't work. Pakistani Taliban also sent suicide bombers to Barcelona in January of 2008. So it's not inconceivable. However, we see no evidence of it so far. And the Haqqani network seems to be, pretty successfully tying down a lot of American troops in eastern Afghanistan and being able to attack in Kabul. So, for them, that may be sufficient. In the back here.
My name is Sarish. I was wondering, Pakistanis were very enraged by OBL episode, that especially that Pakistani sovereignty was violated. Do you think it was a good decision by Pakistani military and the government to not address the people of Pakistan and explain to them what happened? And my second question is, a lot of strategy that U.S. has been utilizing, especially regarding drone attacks and OBL episode, which is violating the sovereignty of these countries. What do you think will be the implication of these, for future? Thank you.
Let's do the thought experiment where a very large group of mafia families were living in Buffalo, New York, and upstate New York, and Canada was sending drones that were killing these mafia families in Buffalo, New York, and killing a relatively small number of civilians in upstate New York as well. I think most Americans would be pretty angry about it, even if they were happy that this mafia family was being eradicated in Buffalo, New York. And so it's not at all surprising that a lot of Pakistanis are extremely angry about the drone strikes in their country, as any, I think as any country would be. It's complicated by the fact that the Pakistani government has been sort of complicit or has, acquiesced in these drone strikes for a long time. Now they're really seriously pushing back. The number of drone strikes is going down pretty markedly. In 2010, there were 118. 2011, there were 70. I can't remember the exact count now, but let's say there have been 20 this year. Part of that is a result of the Pakistani pushback. Part of that is a result of a CIA drone base being closed in Balochistan. And part of that is because there are fewer targets in Al-Qaeda now. And part of that also is because there's been a recognition, I think, in the U.S. government that merely because you can do something doesn't mean you should be doing it all the time. And I think technology has allowed, you know, the drone technology has got much, much better over time, and it's much more discriminatory, and we're killing fewer civilians. The idea we're killing zero Pakistani civilians fails common sense tests, I think. But we're killing very relatively small numbers. So that's not so much the issue. It's the Pakistani sovereignty issue, which you point out, which is the same thing that the bin Laden raid. And you know, people in Pakistan are very angry. And I think if the cost of a successful drone program is that we just anger 180 million Pakistanis for a very long time, I think that's a very hard, large cost to pay. That said, many of the drone attacks have killed enemies of the Pakistani people and state. Bayatullah Masood, I was in Pakistan when he was killed, the leader of the Pakistani Taliban, has the blood of hundreds or even thousands of Pakistanis on his hands. And in fact, there was quite a people in Pakistan, I think, were pretty happy that it was killed. You know, I was there when Bayatullah was killed. I think the headline in the Dawn newspaper was good riddance, Bayatullah, you know. So some of these drone strikes are clearly being done in Pakistan's interests. And I think if there was a more transparent drone program with more Pakistani buy-in and less Pakistani kind of trying to have both sides of, you know, and the Pakistani officials have had to sort of have both sides of the issue and sort of publicly saying we're against this and privately sort of encouraging it. And I think this is the most public covert program in the history of secret things. I mean, a drone strike is by its very nature a public event, and I don't quite understand the secrecy that surrounds it at this point. Pretty, you know, President Obama talked about the drone program in a Google Hangout. So, you know, the president has the ultimate right to declassify things. It's not a secret. We should be having a much richer discussion about this, because there is a very defensible, presumably quite defensible, justification, legal justification for this program. We've heard like shards of it from Harold Coe and others. There is a defensible rationale for the people that are being killed in this. I mean, when Bayatullah Masood is killed or when a leader within al-Qaeda is killed, I think you can easily defend that. What is not defensible is the kind of signature strikes, so-called, which we've seen, or is much harder to defend, where just, you know, a bunch of bearded guys in the Pakistani tribal region get together and they're regarded to be a group of militants. And, you know, I think that is not defensible. So a wider public discussion of this, I think, would be in Pakistan's interest, our interests. And one final point on this. The United States was not able to arm its drones until after 9/11. I think something like Fatima, who has the microphone here, has just been investigating how many countries have drones. And there are about 60 countries that have drones now that, you know, appear to have relatively sophisticated drone programs. It is very, you know, it is within the next year, 2 years, 3 years, the Chinese will be able to arm their drones. Within the next 1, 2, 3 years, the Russians will be able to arm their drones. Will the Russians use drones against Chechens? Will the Chinese use drones against the Uyghurs? You know, we don't know. But the fact is that we're creating a set of precedents that any country whose kind of policies we may not fully embrace will be able to say, hey, you've created the precedents here. And so I think there's a very strong public interest for a wider discussion of drones. And I think the fact that President Obama has presided over a massive expansion of the drone program has precluded some of the same discussion that happened under George W. Bush about Guantanamo. You know, George W. Bush was roundly criticized for the lack of due process at Guantanamo. There's no greater lack of due process than just being the judge, jury, and executioner in a drone strike. And we often execute people in this country who turn out to be innocent. I don't want to say often, but even after years of judicial review, we still execute innocent people. So the idea that we're routinely killing 100% evil people in these drone strikes fails a common sense test. And so I think that it is in our benefit for us to have a deeper discussion of this, because this is the future of warfare. In the back there, sir.
Thank you. Daud Khatak, what future do you see for Al-Qaeda in the region, I mean Afghanistan and Pakistan, after the withdrawal of US and NATO in 2014? And secondly, what can be or what should be the strategy, apart from drones, to counter the threat? Thank you.
So what was the first part of the question, Daud?
My first question was that what future do you see for Al-Qaeda in the region, meaning Afghanistan and Pakistan?
Well, by way, is a,
what strategy should be, apart from drones, to counter the threat?
Dawood is a leading Pashtun journalist at Radio Free Europe, who's from Swat, where, after all, the Taliban seemed to be, you know, the Taliban really had entrenched themselves in 2009. What future for Al-Qaeda in the region? I think their future is very, very, I think the future is not good for Al-Qaeda. I don't mean, as a kind of corollary of that, I'm not advocating a precipitous withdrawal from Afghanistan, because I think that we have strong strategic interests in making sure that Al-Qaeda, that the Taliban doesn't take over part of the country. Because the problem, of course, is not just Al-Qaeda. The problem is Islamic movement of Uzbekistan, the Islamic Jihad Union, Lashkar-e-Taiba, the Pakistani Taliban. I mean, there are a lot of groups that, in one way or another, threaten either regional stability or, in some cases, you know, could carry out an attack in the West of some kind. So the prognosis for Al-Qaeda is grim, but, you know, I think that I'm heartened by the fact that the Obama administration says that we'll be in Afghanistan in a significant way till 2024. I think that's the right signal to send to everybody in the region, and it's the right thing to do. What can we do other than drones? Is an interesting question. We just had an arrest by the Pakistanis of an Al-Qaeda, European Al-Qaeda figure. So, you know, you can arrest people. Arresting people comes freighted with problems. You have to put them in the judicial system, and, you know, one of the side effects of killing people with drones is you don't have to send them to Guantanamo. I'm sure it's not an intended reason for the program, but it is a kind of side effect. So, but you can arrest people, and, you know, arresting people is, you know, dead men don't tell tales. And so arresting people comes, you know, you can gather a lot of information from people even who don't want to cooperate with you. So when Khalid Sheikh Mohammed was arrested, he was arrested with multiple phones, multiple computers. He had letters from bin Laden on his person. There was a lot of just forensic information that you could gather from KSM, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, because he was arrested rather than killed in a drone strike. So there are other options other than drones, but I'm not saying that drones are something that you can't, I'm not saying we should end the drone program, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that it should be done with more discrimination, it should be done with more Pakistani buy-in, it should be a tool that is used really for people that are threats, that are real threats to the United States, and or to Pakistan itself. You know, President Obama, even if you take the minimal number of people killed in drone strikes in Pakistan and Yemen under President Obama, it's 2,000 people. That's more than twice the number of people who've gone to Guantanamo. And, you know, it defies common sense that all these people, were it was necessary to kill all these people. In the front here.
Thank you, Russell Emery. I have one comment on the greatly reduced circumstances of bin Laden, and it's not necessarily that he was humbled by this, because the fundamentalist wing of Islam does go toward a very plain existence, as it does in Christianity with monasteries and sure. Also with Judaism. So. And about the toilet the size of the podium, you know, as you know, some people could say he was a rich man that gave a lot up.
Well, you're absolutely right. In fact, this is the way bin Laden had lived since he'd been in the Sudan in the mid 90s. I mean, this was a guy. Khartoum is one of the hottest places in the world. He, you know, had no air conditioning. When he was living in Afghanistan, there was a choice about moving to somewhere in Kandahar. He chose the place without air conditioning or running water. And so bin Laden, as you point out, he's sort of an ultra-fundamentalist, and for him, this life of poverty was part of the way that he saw that as a religious expression. Mm-hmm. So it was not out of character for him to live like this at all.
Okay, yeah, I have a question, too.
Yeah.
In September of 2007, there was an intelligence company called Sept, who were handed a video before its release by Al-Qaeda or Osama bin Laden, and it was given to the a couple of officials high up in the Bush administration at 11 a.m. And then by the afternoon, it was had been distributed all over. I think it was on YouTube. Had you know, come into the media and so forth. Of course, their contacts were all blown, and they'd been developing them for a while. Did that have any influence possibly on extending this this tenure hunt?
I remember the story, and I'm not really sure what the answer is to that. Sight, which is a company that monitors jihadi communications, was it monitoring some kind of channel that they were using, and this was sort of blown. You know, was it a big deal? You know, I don't know. Anybody can go online and see the story. I'm not convinced it was a big deal, but I don't know enough about it.
Okay, thank you.
Lady here.
What do you think we can and should do to improve the U.S.-Pakistan relationship? And you mentioned, for example, we should get buy-in for the drones, but is that even possible?
Yeah, it is possible. I mean, for two reasons. First of all, the CIA had a base in Pakistan. It was the main base for the drone attacks. I mean, so it's not implausible. And if the Pakistanis really wanted to end the drone program, they could shoot them out of the sky with their F-16s. I mean, they're very slow-moving, relatively speaking. So there is some buy-in. And but by the way, something that almost never gets mentioned, there's a big discussion of the ground kind of lines of communication through Pakistan, and the fact that Pakistanis have closed them. If they closed their airspace to our flights into Kandahar, which is one of the busiest airports in the world, that would be a big problem for us. And they haven't done it, and they haven't even suggested it. And it's a subject of non-public discussion. So the point is that it's a very difficult relationship, as you know. If they really wanted to turn the heat up on our efforts in Afghanistan beyond what they already have done, they could do so, and they haven't. So I think, you know, how could we improve our relations? So let me give you a very concrete example. The European Union has just relatively recently announced no tariffs for Pakistan, which is a very pretty big deal. If we tax French textiles, I think at 3%, and we tax Pakistani textiles at 12%. Textiles make up the bulk of Pakistani manufacturing, and it's a country with huge problems. And, you know, if we lowered our tariffs, which is something that has been discussed for years, you know, that would go a long way. They don't want our aid, which always comes freighted with a lot of caveats and preconditions, and they want our trade. They want freer trade with the United States. That is something that is absolutely something that they would want. The problem is, what they mostly have to offer is textiles, and the South Carolina delegation in Congress is not about to allow the U.S. textile manufacturing in their area to be undercut. And right now, doing anything good for Pakistan in the U.S. Congress would be impossible because, you know, there is so much bad blood. But that is something pretty concrete, I think, that we can do, that we could do. That's the principle.
And I am no part of any fundamentalist extremist group.
Well done. Talk to the microphone, sir.
I have no sympathy with Stalin, Hitler,
okay,
Shah of Iran, Saddam Hussein,
I see a butt
Hosni
coming.
Mubarak, Gaddafi, al-Bashar Assad, and a few more leaders in the world today. But my question is based on enough is enough. I know that the vice premier of Israel recently gave a statement and showing some desire to have peace in the Middle East. And I'm talking about the root cause of creation of terrorists. What we have to do to bring peace in the Middle East, Kashmir, Chechnya, what do we have to do about it?
What do we have to do to bring peace in the Middle East? Well, that's above my pay grade. I mean, I think the answer is pretty well known. And clearly, Yeah, the Kashmir problem is not dissimilar to the Israeli-Palestinian problem in the sense that it's you can blame the British for both of them. And the outlines of a settlement are well known to all parties. I mean, Steve Cole, my boss and friend and colleague, you know, wrote the definitive piece in The New Yorker about how close Musharraf and his Indian, you know, interlocutors came to a deal on Kashmir. They came this close. And we know at Camp David that Clinton came pretty close. So we know what the essential, we know what the deal would look like in both cases. The question is, what are the politics to get you there? And you know, Musharraf, as the deal came closer on Kashmir, suddenly Musharraf was presented by enormous political problems at home and he lost all credibility with the Pakistani population. And it's a public diplomacy issue because the Pakistani population has been told for so long that this is an incredibly important thing and India is wrong and you know what has been said. You can't just sort of undo that overnight. And it's a sort of Nixon goes to China thing and Musharraf could have delivered it. But he became politically, just the politics were not there. And as you know, the politics in Israel now, a deal seems less and less plausible. I mean, you know, the settlements are going forward. So, I mean, these are very, very difficult problems. There are, by the way, to say that solving all these issues would sort of magically make terrorism go away, I'm not convinced that's true. Because I think there is a sort of fanatical personality who will attach themselves to violence and is sort of opportunistic about the reasons that they do that. It isn't necessarily, I mean, sure, these issues play a role, but Bin Laden had 53 siblings. Not one of them took up arms against the United States or the Saudi government or, you know, there is a sort of element of individual choice here. And I'm sure of his 53 siblings, a lot of them were unhappy about the Israeli situation and may have been unhappy about Kashmir, but violence is something that will be utilized by people, I think, you know, that goes beyond simply the kind of rationales that they say that they are engaging in violence. I think for some people it's, in some cases, fun. I think of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed as somebody who basically enjoyed being a terrorist rather than being a sort of basically a religious fanatic. So, yes, it would help if these things were answered. But there is always going to be, particularly in the Middle East right now, unemployed young men who are going to attach themselves to ideologies that may encourage violence because they don't have much hope and their societies aren't providing them much hope. And I just think that's the nature of human, of being human, perhaps.
To a lot of Americans, it seems sort of inconceivable that Bin Laden could have been in this compound and no one knew about it. So for those of us who aren't as familiar with how he could have,
hidden
for so long, can you talk a little bit more? Wasn't the Pakistani state that was helping him, who is he getting assistance from and how is it possible that he could hide for so long?
Well, he was getting, you know, the main assistance was coming from the two couriers. The two couriers were brothers. The brothers were the perfect people to hide him because they were called, Al-Kuwaiti, which means, you know, Ahmed Al-Kuwaiti was the name of the first courier. They weren't really from Kuwait. They were from Swat in northern Pakistan. Their father had emigrated to Kuwait 50 years ago and is a preacher in Kuwait. As you know, Kuwaitis do not grant citizenship to anybody who isn't Kuwaiti. So they lived as sort of second-class citizens in Kuwait. They grew up speaking Arabic, but they also grew up speaking Pashto, which is the language of northwest Pakistan. They were the perfect people to hide Bin Laden's because they could communicate with the Arab leadership of Al-Qaeda in Arabic, and they could communicate in Pashto and be locals in Abbottabad and other places around it. And they seemed to be the local guys. Now, you may recall in October of 2005, there was a devastating earthquake in Kashmir, which Kashmir is very close to Abbottabad. There was a lot of reconstruction going on. That was right when Bin Laden built this building. And so he was able to take advantage of that. There were a lot of people moving into Abbottabad from the surrounding areas, because they were refugees from this huge earthquake in Kashmir that killed 75,000 people. And so the fact that this building was being built was not unusual. The fact that it looked like it did was not unusual at all, because there were a lot of wealthy Afghan refugees in the area, and they're building houses that are sort of, you know, have purdah elements, so that women are not seen from outside. And you know, Bin Laden only lived on, he lived on, you know, in U.S. terms, he lived on the second floor and the third floor, and he didn't. He went, you know, he had a brief walk, you know, infrequently. It was like under, and you know, he did it under a tarpaulin. He had no idea that the Americans were trying to, yeah, just said, you know, we spent a lot of satellites over and drones by, you know, the summer of 2010, the fall of 2010, and they were never able to get a shot at Bin Laden because he was, you know, hyper paranoid. You know, even on the off chance that an American satellite might go over, he was doing his exercise under a tarpaulin. So, you know, he was being very careful. And they were growing their own crops, and they had cows, they had chickens, they had honeybees, they were growing cucumbers, they had a vegetable garden. You know, they were completely self-contained. Bin Laden never left, his wives never left. You know, they were being very, 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 very careful. You know, and Brian mentioned that the CIA had no leads for years. I mean, they had nothing. Bupkis, to use the New York term. And so they went, you know, kind of in desperation, they started looking at other manhunts to say, are there any other lessons we can learn? Now, Eichmann, who was the subject of the, you know, very intense manhunt by the Israelis, took 15 years. How was Eichmann caught? It was something the CIA was interested in. So, I mean, if you look at the history of Eichmann, basically, his son was dating a girl, and he kind of blabbed, he was boasting to the girl and her father about his dad's Nazi past. The father was not impressed by this and called a friend in Germany who was a federal judge who'd investigated Nazis, Nazi crimes. Somehow Mossad got hold of this information and then, of course, famously kidnapped Eichmann from Buenos Aires. And so what was the lesson of that? It's like the family can give you away, you know, the inadvertent kind of discussions. And so, you know, Bin Laden, if he didn't want to get caught at all, he would have stopped communicating with members of Al-Qaeda completely, because there would have been no courier network to. But, you know, he decided to continue to do that. And so he was taking a minor, minor risk, and it would turn into a big risk over time. But it looked like a minor risk to continue to be in touch with the top leaders of Al-Qaeda. But, you know, I think in answer to your question, he was being pretty careful. And think about Whitey Bulger, by the way. Whitey Bulger, you know, it took longer to find Whitey Bulger than it did to find Osama bin Laden. And, you know, the FBI put a great deal of effort into trying to find him. And he was living in, I don't know, somewhere in California on the beach with his girlfriend. And, you know, why did it take so long to find Whitey Bulger? Probably because he was very careful. Why was he found? You know, probably because his girlfriend said something stupid to somebody at some point. You know, and that's how people get caught. I mean, human beings, I was confident that we would find bin Laden because human beings, by their nature, will make a mistake at a certain point. It seems to be something very, you know, it's a very visceral thing. The Pakistanis should have known. Let me answer one final way. We spent about $1 trillion, we spent at least $500 billion, in my view, trying to find bin Laden. If you add up all the sort of intelligence, you know, if you add up the intelligence budget since 9/11. And we also spent 10 years, and a lot of very, very bright people in the US government got up every morning to go to work and think about this problem. And it still took 10 years for us to find bin Laden. So, you know, it wasn't that easy, it turns out. It took 5 years to find Eric Rudolph. It took 4 years to kill Mir Amil Kansi, who killed two CIA employees right outside the gate of CIA headquarters in Langley, Virginia in 1993. It just takes a while to find people who aren't making obvious mistakes.
Thanks again, Peter. You are the Michael Jordan of this subject, so obviously you have a record to build on, unlike LeBron James.
I know nothing about American football.
Is it Muhammad Kahani?
What's that?
Is it Muhammad Kahani? The courier in chief, the fellow who had this
Ahmed Al-Kuwaiti.
Okay, sorry. Mixing up my characters. Could you sort of give a backstory of this guy. I found him to be one of the most fascinating folks in the book. Played this very fateful role, I think, of his interest in joining the attackers, and then wound up.
So you were right. Muhammad al-Qahtani. Okay. Muhammad al-Qahtani was supposed to be the 20th hijacker. I'm glad you raised this, because another issue that I should have talked about earlier. Muhammad al-Qahtani was a very, I would say, not a very sophisticated Saudi, who basically was in a bunch of dead-end jobs. He was, you know, kind of a messenger, and he suddenly had a religious awakening, went to Afghanistan, joined al-Qaeda, and was at the Battle of Torabora. And as he joined al-Qaeda, bin Laden basically said, you know, we have a mission, you should go to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed said, I'm sending you to the United States. He was a Saudi, so it was very easy for him to get in the United States at the time, unlike if he was a Yemeni. And he goes to Orlando Airport in the summer of 2001. Mohammed Atta, the lead hijacker, is waiting for him. A very kind of smart INS officer says, this guy doesn't speak English, he's on a one-way ticket, I don't like his attitude, and I'm sending him back home. And so it is possible that if Qahtani had gotten the country, Flight 93 might, you know, they would have had more muscle on the plane, and, you know, they might have been able to get to Washington. So Qahtani was the 20th hijacker. And when he was picked up after the Battle of Torabora, he was then taken to Guantanamo. In Guantanamo, he said, I was in Afghanistan because of my interest in falconry, which was a not uncommon al-Qaeda cover story, but obviously is not true. And about a year later, they matched his fingerprints to the guy who'd been turned down back at Orlando Airport. And suddenly he became the subject of a great deal of interest inside Guantanamo. He was subjected to 45 plus days of very coercive interrogation. So I don't use the word torture in the book, but a federal judge by the name of Susan Crawford, who'd been appointed to the bench by President Reagan and then was appointed by President George W. Bush to run the trials at Guantanamo, said this guy's treatment rises to the level of torture. He cannot be tried for anything. He was kept awake for like 40 days. He was subjected to, you know, very bad music by Christina Aguilera. He was subjected to a whole range of other things, high temperatures, low temperatures. He was forced to perform dog tricks in the naked. He was very, very badly maltreated. He, during the course of his interrogation, said that there was this guy called Abu Ahmed al-Kuwaiti, who played an important role for al-Qaeda, and in fact had trained him before he'd gone to the United States. And clearly somebody who was training this guy on the internet and other things before going to the United States was somebody who was inside al-Qaeda's, somebody who was in Khalid Sheikh Mohammed's inner circle. So this is the first time that the U.S. government becomes aware this guy, Abu Ahmed al-Kuwaiti, is an important guy. So coercive interrogations were used on this person. Now, did he give up this information in the course of them? It's not clear to me, but it's possible. Then another guy called Hassan Gul was picked up in Iraq. He was also coercively interrogated. He also said that Abu Ahmed al-Kuwaiti was bin Laden's courier. Did he give up this information before or after he was coercively interrogated? Not clear. The Senate Intelligence Committee is going to release a massive report, and I think they're going to say that this guy was coercively interrogated, but he gave up the information before the coercive interrogations began. Two final points: Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and Abu Faraj al-Libi, the number threes in al-Qaeda, were both coercively interrogated. They both gave up disinformation about the courier. So the reason I got into all that is, what role did coercive interrogations play in all this? Kind of a mixed bag, as you can tell. They were not, in the end, there were many other techniques that got you to the compound in Abbottabad. Another country gave us, Abu Ahmed al-Kuwaiti means the father of Ahmed from Kuwait. It's not a very precise clue, since the population of Kuwait, I think, is 3 million, and Abu Ahmed, you know, Ahmed is a very common name. A country in 2007 told us his real name, and I think that country was Pakistan, but I can't be sure. In 2010, the National Security Agency intercepted the phone call that this courier made, which allowed them to geolocate the phone to Peshawar, which is a very large city in western Pakistan. And then human intelligence, people on the ground, followed Abu Ahmed back to Abbottabad. So there was a combination of good old-fashioned spies on the ground, classic American signals intelligence, classic liaison relationships with foreign intelligence agencies, in addition to information that came from interrogation. So, you know, there was no one thing you can say that this is the way that we found bin Laden. And for people who say that without coercive interrogation you wouldn't have found bin Laden, I think it's a, I just offer to you, I think why it's a rather complicated. Coercive interrogations did play a role in identifying not the courier, but that Kuwaiti was playing a role in Al-Qaeda, it seems. Could we have elicited this information another way without coercive interrogations? Ramzi Youssef, who was the bomber of the Trade Center in 1993, gave the entire plot away in a flight from Islamabad to Manhattan without any coercive interrogations to Brad Garrett, who's one of the characters in the book. Abu Zubaydah gave the name of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed essentially to Ali Sufan, who's spoken right here in this seat, without coercive interrogations, which was really the beginning of identifying Khalid Sheikh Mohammed as the leader of the 9/11 plot. And there are many other examples. So, you know, we can't run history backward. We just don't know. For the people who say this had nothing to do with coercive interrogation, I think that isn't true either. It is not a black and white answer. It is kind of gray.
Peter, thank you for your presentation. My question is, during the Bush-Cheney years, it went from, the hunt for bin Laden went from dead or alive to the President Bush saying that he didn't care where he was or not interested in his whereabouts. What happened?
Yeah, bin Laden, there was, I quote CIA Director Michael Hayden, who would every Thursday morning at 8 o'clock go into a meeting with George W. Bush, and George W. Bush would say, "How's it going, Mike?" And what he meant was, "How's it going finding bin Laden?" Everybody understood in the Oval Office that that was what that question meant. It didn't mean anything else. George W. Bush did not privately ever let it go. He would have liked to have killed bin Laden. If you look at the drone strikes in the last 6 months of his presidency, I think there were 7 drone strikes in the first 6 months of 2008 and 44 in the last 6 months, and a lot of them were quite effective in killing leaders of Al-Qaeda, but not bin Laden himself. And of course, he wasn't in the tribal areas where the drone strikes are overwhelmingly concentrated. So, you know, whatever publicly he said about it, he didn't privately let it go. And there was clearly no upside for the Bush administration to kind of be saying, "We really want to find bin Laden," when they knew damn well that they didn't really have anything. And so I think that, you know, they basically said, you know, to themselves, there's no reason to amp this guy up more than he is already. Let's just stop talking about him. But that didn't mean that privately they were not pursuing him. And one of the things that, by the way, I say in the book is I talked to 5 senior CIA officials who worked under both President Obama and President Bush, and they all said the idea that President Obama came into office and radically amped up the hunt for bin Laden is ludicrous. I mean, there were people at the agency who kept on looking for bin Laden. One of them, by the way, just walked in, Bob Grenier, who ran the CIA counterterrorist unit and till 2005, and who was, there's a very interesting scene in the book where Bob is negotiating with the number 2 leader of the Taliban on 2 occasions for them to hand over bin Laden, something that they seem to be interested in doing. And so history would have turned out very differently if they'd actually gone through with that. But, you know, George W. Bush wanted to find bin Laden. There was no, you know, whatever confusing signals he might have sent publicly about, you know, him being no longer relevant, that privately he was very intent on finding him. This gentleman over here. I think that will be the last question.
I am Sohail Tajik, a Humphrey Fellow. Umar Patek, he was involved in Bali bombings. He was also arrested from Abbottabad.
Okay, yeah. So one of the guys who was most responsible for the Bali bombings of 2002, which killed 200 mostly Western tourists in Bali, was arrested in Abbottabad in January of 2011. A lot of, you know, why, you know, Abbottabad is a pretty obscure city in Pakistan. Why is somebody who was leading the Bali bombing attacks, which had been financed by Al-Qaeda, showing up in Abbottabad? And this was a real cause of concern for the CIA, which was like, you know, is there something we kind of don't understand about Abbottabad? Or why is this guy here? Is he trying to see bin Laden? At the end of the day, they just said this is one of life's strange coincidences, and that's what it was. There was no, he didn't know bin Laden was there. He wasn't visiting bin Laden, and it was just kind of a coincidence. So with that, I will wind up, and if you want to, I'd love to sign any book that you want to have me sign. Thank you very much.